All right, good morning, Dr. Deuk Majan here at the Deuk Spine Institute. We're starting our live broadcast for spine surgery today. We have a few cases lined up, and our first one is a patient who injured their spine at work, and we call this a workman's comp case. The patient has two herniated discs at C5-6, C6-7. She also has another herniation up at C3-4. But we don't believe that's causing any symptoms. We're only focused on the two at 5667. Now we're gonna perform or attempt to perform a procedure called the Deuk laser disc repair. And what this is, you won't find it done everywhere, so you're not gonna find a lot on the internet about it, but it is a newer technology doing endoscopic spine surgery. And it's outpatient, minimally invasive. Is she relaxed?
Yes.
Blood pressure is good? You can keep the blood pressure a little higher, yeah. So for this kind of case, the blood pressure higher is fine. I like it around 110 systolic. So our patient's laying on her back. Her neck is exposed. Just to orient you, this is the face looking up. She's intubated. This is cased under general endotracheal anesthesia because we want this patient fully relaxed. Now we're on the right side of the neck here, and I'm going to attempt to feel the spine and place a needle into the disc, the first disc that we're gonna fix, which is C5-6. Now I will tell you, and I've told this patient, she has a very thick neck and it's short. So we may not be able to get both discs fixed. We may not be able to get any disc fixed. It is a risk that the patient has to be willing to take, that they'll go to surgery and not be able to do this procedure. And she's willing to do that. I've already talked to her twice about it. So we're gonna do our damn best to get in there safely and get it done. But I am not going to, knowingly put the patient at great risk just to access the disc in this manner. There's another way we can do the surgery open with a bigger incision, and we may end up having to do that, but right now we're gonna try to do it this way because it's a much faster recovery. There's no scar tissue, no swallowing difficulty, and virtually no bleeding. So you're gonna see everything is done through a 4 millimeter incision. How are we doing?
Just getting a little bit less.
All right, so right now she's intubated and we can see that on the x-ray. There's an endotracheal tube, there's an esophageal temperature probe. I use both during the surgery. We're gonna use an 18 gauge spinal needle. I'm gonna do my best to access her disc from the front by palpating. Oh. I can actually feel the spine, which is really a good start. So hopefully shot. Oh, it's pretty far down there, so we don't need to be that far. That's actually a good thing for us, for the patient as well. Shot. All right, why am I not seeing? I need to see that area, 2, 3, 4. Yeah, I need to see that area better. Let's see. Sometime soon. Can barely see the needle. Go ahead and shoot. Really can't see the needle, but I can see the I need to see the 5-6 disc space, and I need to see the needle. Why am I not seeing the needle? Shot. Okay, not really seeing the needle that well. All right. Shot. Let's get the AP view. That's better on the needle. Give me an AP view quickly. So we're gonna do a quick anterior posterior view. I need to make sure the needle tip is where I want it to be, which is heading towards the middle. Good, lateral. So I can see the needle is sitting right over the middle of the spine. That's where I want it. And to enter the disc through the front, you wanna be about a centimeter left or right of the midline. You can tell the midline based on the spinous processes. All right, we need to see better, guys. Okay, and shot. Shot. Can you tell if that's at the, it's a little below the disc? Shot. I need to see that disc better, guys. Give me an AP, it looks pretty good. Give me a quick AP, quick. My fingers are killing me. Shot. That looks good. Sean? Sean? We're definitely inside the 5-6. All right, good. So just going to rest my fingers for a minute because this procedure takes a beating on your fingers if the neck is thick, which hers is thick. All right, so let's just regroup for a moment. I'd like to see C2 clearly, so I need you to move the fluoro north just a little bit and take a picture. All right, so you can see C2 there at the top. It's a tall bone. And then there's a space 3, space 4, space 5, space 6. So number 5-6 has a big bone spur in the front. Looks like a bird's beak. We are not going to do anything with that because it's not causing any problems for the patient. No symptoms, no complaints. The anterior osteophytes almost never do. Well, we are in the C5-6 disc space, and I'm happy with that. So at least we're going to be able to fix this one, and I think we'll probably be able to get the next one as well, hopefully. All right, so at this point, we're going to do our discogram. Blood pressure is good. Yeah, I would keep it down around 110. You know, not any higher than that, maybe 115. So at this point, we're going to do our discogram. I'm going to take the stylet out. I'm going to need to see that 5-6 disc a little better. So whatever you got to do, 110 is perfect. That's what we can do right there. That looks pretty good. All right. So basically, this is all post-processing of the image. Yeah. So the information's actually there. You just don't see it until you post-process it. Yeah. All right. Yeah. All right. So at this point, we're going to do our discogram. You can see we're at 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So. And shot. All right, let's see down by it, down there at 5-6. All right, not bad, not bad. Show them with the arrow the tear, the annular tear. You can see there's a tear in the back of the disc. There's a black line, yep, right there. Nope, a little lower. The annular tear, yes, that. It looks like a mustache. So go from left, there it is. Perfect, thank you, Jordan, good job. That is the annular tear. That's where the herniation is coming out of, and that's in the back of the disc. We're a little rotated on orbit. We're probably about a degree off on the orbit, but you know, it is what it is. It's still a good image. Point is, you can see the tear in the back of the disc, and now we're going to go fix that tear, and we're going to take the herniation out as well. And all this is done with a procedure called the Deuk laser disc repair. Why don't you run the animation, Kevin, of how herniated discs, annular tears, how they cause neck pain while we get ourselves into the disc. That's a nice picture.
Traumatic injury on the disc can cause annular tears to form. Pressure on the disc causes herniation of the nucleus pulposus through the annular tear. Inflammatory tissue develops within the annular tear, causing neck pain. The inflamed annular tear generates pain signals. Additional injuries can cause worsening symptoms. Inflammation from the annular tear can spread to the nearby nerve roots, causing arm pain. Pain signals travel up the nerves to the brain, causing localized neck pain. Pain signals reach the primary somatosensory cortex, causing conscious awareness of neck pain. If you have a herniated or bulging disc and neck pain, Submit your MRI for a free review at www.mri.dukespine.com.
Okay, well, you've just watched the animation showing how a annular tear occurs from trauma in the back of the disc and how the jelly from the center of the disc can actually push through that tear and make a herniation. And then once the herniation happens, you get pain from inflammation. And that's what patients have, is painful inflammation in the back of the disc. That's what we're targeting today, is to go in and repair that tear by debriding it. It allows her body to heal it. All right, so we're at the front of the spine at this point. Now, what am I seeing over there? I can see the bone spur, but I can't really see the vertebral body below. Is that parallax effect, or is that just poor? Maybe we're off on the orbit a little bit. What do you guys think? Is there? I think we're still a little bit off on orbit. That's better. Can you give me an AP view? So in a lateral view, I'm happy with the position of the dilator and the guide wire. The guide wire is sitting inside the C5-6 disc that is damaged. That's the one that we're going to be fixing. Give me an AP. AP view is perfect. You can see the tip of the dilator in the front of the disc is right in the center. So now I can safely advance the dilator into the disc. Remember, the center of the disc is a jelly, so it doesn't get hurt by advancing this dilator at all. Okay, now, why does that disc look so weird to me? Is it a wag issue? I mean, the orbit is fine. I don't know if we're wagged off. We may need to wag so we can see that vertebral body a little better. That is better, for sure. All right, but okay, so I'm gonna go ahead and at this point, we're gonna push the dilator and twist it to go through the anterior longitudinal ligament, which is in the front of the spine. And what the dilator is doing is it's spreading the fibers open and moving through them. So it's not damaging anything, it's actually just spreading. Spreading tissues doesn't damage tissues. As long as you spread them very little, you avoid trauma. Shot? All right, so at this point, we're inside the disc. I could safely remove the guide wire, and I'm going to advance the dilator through the disc. Shot? And I'm going to advance it all the way to the back of the disc where the tear is. Now, it's important as you do this, you kind of let the dilator find its way. You don't force it up or down. Otherwise, it's going to end up going into the bone, and you don't want that. You want to just go into the back of the disc where the tear is. All right, let's go ahead and, for our audience, show them exactly what we're doing here today, how the Deuk laser disc repair works.
The inflamed annular tear causes neck pain. Inflammation of the nerve roots causes arm pain. A Band-Aid-sized skin incision is made. A small tube is inserted without damaging the bone or soft tissues. The laser removes the herniation and debrides the annular tear. The annular tear heals on its own. It can take up to 12 months. If you have a herniated or bulging disc and neck pain, submit your MRI for a free review at www.mri.dukespine.com.
All right, we are advancing the tube that we're going to do the whole surgery through over the dilator at this point to get to the back of that disc. And you can see, just stay there, please.
Sure.
You can see the dilator has moved back. I don't want that, so I'm going to advance it again. If you don't pay attention to the dilator, you can either advance it into the spinal canal, which is bad. It can go a little bit, but not much. Shot. Or you can have it back out like it's doing right now. And you don't want it backing out because then you're going to be biopsying. You don't want to biopsy the disc or the vertebral body. Shot. You want to shot. You want to just advance that tube over the dilator. Shot. So I'm just going right a little bit into the epidural space. I'm going to advance this tube one more time, a little distraction, and then we'll be done. That should be it. Good. Perfect. Right there. Done. Yes. That's it. Nice. Perfect. All right. We're all the way at the back of the disc. You can see that. And I'm going to remove this herniation. So let's take a look at what we've got here. Can you see this here? Before
yes,
you take that out.
Yes, sir.
So we're literally taking a surgery. You have a marker? That would normally be an anterior cervical discectomy infusion. And the incision for that on this patient would be something like this. Okay? And it would come all the way down to about here. We're taking this big invasive incision, and instead we're doing with a 4-millimeter incision. We're doing this surgery arthroscopically or endoscopically. We're avoiding scar tissue, bleeding, damage to the esophagus, swallowing tube, difficulty swallowing. We're avoiding damage to the vocal cords. Can you pull that back a little bit? Yeah, perfect. We're avoiding the need for post-operative narcotic pain medication like you would need with a fusion or an artificial disc. So this is revolutionary surgery you're watching. It's done with a tiny 4-millimeter incision. We've been doing this surgery now for 16 years here at Deuk Spine Institute. And the actual procedure is called the Deuk Laser Disc Repair. We pioneered one part of the endoscopic procedure called an annular debridement. It was the first that it's ever been done in the world. And it's the most important part of the surgery. It's something that's overlooked by all other spine surgeons. And we've published this surgery, and we have had it published multiple times. It's in textbooks now on endoscopic surgery. Just in 2022, in January, the most advanced endoscopic spine surgery textbook was just printed and published, and this Deuk Laser Disc Repair is in there. I just gave a talk in Los Angeles to leaders in the world in new advances in spine surgery at the Society for Brain Mapping and Therapeutics. And it was a well-received talk. I talked about doing this in the cervical spine like we're doing today, but also in the thoracic. All right. So there's the back of the disc herniation. Those are pieces of herniated disc. We're going to start removing them with the laser. Any questions from our audience?
No, sir, not at the moment.
All right. You can see the laser fiber at 12 o'clock. And we're going to be removing these herniation fragments a little bit at a time. Now, this patient, she hurt her neck at work. And what happened was she tore that disc and herniated the jelly from the center out through the tear. That's what you're seeing on the MRI. Can they see the MRI?
Yes,
sir. Use the grabber. Great. So on the MRI, you can see that there's a bulging in the back of the disc. Okay, who has the scope? Yeah, whoever is managing the scope has to turn it off whenever I bring it out. Now you're watching, if you're watching today on March 29th, 2022, you're probably watching our live stream. So we're sending this surgery out live around the world for people to watch and learn. I'm going to make an adjustment. I think we're a little bit overexposed. Let's bring the light exposure down. Yeah, that's better. Thank you. The exposure for the lighting is different for cervical and lumbar. For lumbar, it's you need higher light because the scope is bigger. And for cervical, we need lower light. All right. So what I'm seeing here are pieces of herniated disc, and you can see the laser is the glass tube at 12 o'clock, and it's basically breaking up the herniations into smaller pieces so they can come out. What you really may not be able to appreciate, there's a herniation right there. You see that? That's awesome. It just popped out. We call that a reverse herniation. It's reverse because a herniation is when the nuclear jelly from the center goes to the outside of the disc, and a reverse is when it goes from the outside back in. And that's just what happened. And how is that possible? Well, herniations occur when the disc is under pressure. But there has to be an annular tear first. So the first step in all herniations is an annular tear. After the annular tear, the patient does something like lift something or carry something, and that puts pressure on the disc. And that pressure shoves the jelly out of the disc. And by shoving the jelly out of the disc, it goes, where does it go? Well, it goes through the tear. So if the tear is in the back of the disc, the jelly is going to go through that tear behind the disc. And what's behind the disc? That's where the spinal cord is in the neck. That's where nerves are. So when the jelly goes out the back tear in the back of the disc, it causes problems like pinched nerves, because that's where the nerves exit the spine, and spinal cord damage. So a lot of patients with herniated discs in the cervical spine or their neck end up with pinched nerves, which cause numbness, tingling, and weakness down your arm, or spinal cord damage, which, you know, causes difficulty walking, trouble with your hands, coordination of your hands, things like that. So depending on where the what the herniation does in the back of the disc, it can cause different symptoms. There's a big herniation right there, two of them. So I'm not going to be able to laser those down. They're just too big. So I got to try to, can you guys see this when I reach in, Kevin?
Yes, sir.
I got to reach in with a little grabber, and that grabber pulls out the pieces of herniation one at a time. And so the laser and the grabber work together. Oh, I felt kind of a big one coming. Huh? Yeah. Oh, there's another big one. You see how the fluid sucks down? I just can't get it. Maybe too big. Now, the other thing about these surgeries you may have noticed is there's very little bleeding. Generally, we lose only a small amount of blood. Just a few. There's a herniation. Look at the size of that thing. It wants to come out, but it's too big to fit. So I'm going to try to grab it again and pull it out. Hey, Jordan, do you mind training her how to turn the light off? Maybe we got it. Nope. Still, I couldn't get it out. I feel it. I feel like I'm starting to get it out, but it just doesn't come out. So I'll have to break it up a little more. That's really what I do is, just watch your body. Don't get close to Luis. You don't want to contaminate him. All right, so here we are. Once again, that herniation's still there. I can't get it because it's too big. So I have to try to chop it up into littler pieces. Now, one of the things about the laser that's so useful, and people, you know, that don't know what they're talking about, they say lasers aren't necessary or useful in spine surgery. They honestly, those are people who have no experience whatsoever with lasers. I wouldn't be able to do this surgery without the laser. It's impossible. And the laser allows me to do several things. If you think about the surgery, it's really two main parts. One is removing the herniations, and two is debriding the annular tear. And the removing the herniations, you can't do it unless you can break the herniations up into smaller pieces, okay? But if you don't break the herniations up into smaller pieces, you're not gonna get them out. You gotta release them. They're stuck to the annular tear. They don't wanna come out. And without the laser, you won't get them out. So the laser is essential to doing the surgery. Now what we're seeing here is the end plate. Oh, there's another herniation. You see that? It came out of the epidural space, literally where the nerve is and the spinal cord is. So that's another piece. But notice how I didn't break that piece off. It just came out that way. So what does that tell you? It tells you that's a herniation itself, by itself. That's what they look like. There's another one, okay, smaller, okay? But the point is, all these pieces of herniation, they all are different geometrically. Some are bigger, some are smaller. And each one of them is its own distinct event, meaning that this herniation didn't happen in one time. It probably happened, she injured her neck at work, and then she probably herniated out a few pieces, and perhaps even has herniated more out since her injury. So guess what? There's another herniation. If she would have injured her neck, herniated her disc right away, and came to me right away, and we did this surgery right away, then she would have less herniations. And that's true for everybody. The more time you wait to fix it, the more herniations that happen, the more degeneration of your disc that happens. So by waiting, you're actually causing more damage. I'm not the first person that says that. I'm just the first person to show it with the endoscope, you know? Because that's exactly what's happening. As long as that gate's open, more herniations are going to be coming out. So everyone talks about delay, delay, delay care. We don't recommend delaying care for a herniated disc. So the whole spine world is just honestly back ass right now in the year, you know, 2022. And it's been that way for years. And that's why we broadcast. We want to teach people the truth, because you're not going to get the truth from your doctors. You're not going to get the truth from your insurance companies, because they don't want, there's another herniation. They don't want you to have surgery. Surgery is expensive. They want you to just live with the problem. Okay? And then go somewhere else, maybe even die, so you're not their problem anymore. They don't have to pay for you. Okay? Yeah, it sounds harsh and cruel and Dr. Deuk's so mean, but that's the God's honest truth. They just honestly want you to live and pay the premium and not get care. That's every insurance company's goal, is to collect the monthly payment from you and not give you any medical treatment. So to the extent they can get away with it, they do. There was a very important legal ruling that happened this last week. Okay, United Healthcare has been denying paying for behavioral health. Behavioral health is people that have mental conditions, you know, psychological or mental conditions, and they need medical care. And United Healthcare has been denying them benefits, denying paying. And they've been collecting money for those benefits but not paying them out. So there was a big lawsuit and they lost. United Healthcare lost, and the lower court said that United Healthcare should have paid those benefits, and that by not paying it, it basically was just enriching itself at the expense of these poor people who didn't get the benefits they were supposed to get. So United Healthcare, of course, appealed that decision and went to the appellate court, which is the next level up. And the appellate court sided with United Healthcare and said, you know what, United Healthcare just has to follow their contract, whatever they put in their contract of what they would provide. And it says in their contract that they will only pay for medically necessary care. But these judges ruled that, okay, yeah, they have to only pay for medically necessary care, but they don't always have to pay for medically necessary care. In other words, the care may be medically necessary, but that doesn't matter because they don't have to pay for it. So basically, the insurance company, if they don't have to pay for medically necessary care, that's the standard of care, then what do they have to pay for? The answer is nothing. They don't have to pay for anything. So that decision by the appellate court last week for United Healthcare in favor of the insurance company basically says insurance companies don't have to pay for anything, whether or not it's necessary. That doesn't decide whether they have to pay for it. It's just whatever they write in their contract, their condition of coverage. This is shocking. This is horrible for people. This is horrible for the general public. This is the worst decision the appellate court could possibly make. It basically says insurance companies can take your money and not give you anything in return. It's at their discretion. That's what that decision was. And, you know, the lawyers who fought the insurance company got no money. They've spent over $20 million of their own to fight for the people's rights for behavioral health, and they get nothing. They basically paid for that trial and got nothing in return, not even a verdict in favor of the public. So we have a real problem in America, folks. And I'll keep talking about these issues because nobody's asking me questions about the surgery. So if you don't want to hear me talk about these issues, then just keep asking me questions.
We have one question, sir.
Oh, all right. So somebody who doesn't want to hear me talk about insurance companies. Good. Yes, what is the question?
I had a failed microdiscectomy 6 weeks ago, actually in worse pain than before the surgery. Surgeon wants to do a two-level fusion now. Is the disc repair an option or any other options available?
Yeah, this disc repair is an option for you. So great question from one of our viewers from what, Facebook, Twitter?
YouTube. YouTube. Dan.
All right, Dan. Thanks for asking. I'm Dr. Deuk Majan. Great question. We get this question often. If you've had a failed microdiscectomy, are you a candidate for laser? 100% yes. Do not get that fusion. Do not get that fusion. We can still fix you. I'm confident of that. Now, I don't know 100%, but I'd say just without even looking at your pictures, 98% chance we can help you with your back pain, get rid of it, and your leg symptoms. I need to see your MRI, and I need to talk to you and see what kind of problems you're having. And of course, ultimately, I'll need to examine you. But we've had many, many patients over the years who've had microdiscectomy. There's another herniation right there. See it? It's like just wants to come out of that foramen. Oh, yeah. Come on out. Got to help it with the laser. There's no way that would come out of there without the laser. You see what I mean? Here it comes. Got to have the laser. People who say laser is not necessary for spine surgery, honestly, they are full of shit. Okay? I'm sorry, but that's the truth. Don't listen to them. Don't believe them. They just don't know what they're talking about. Okay, so your MRI can be submitted. Kevin, will you put the link up? MRI.dukespine.com. We'll look at it for
yes,
free.
Sir.
Oh, there's another herniation right there. Just came out. I think this patient's going to do so well. I hope she does. A lot of herniations here at C5-6. Come on. You can see I float these out. If I have to go in and put the grabber every time, it's not as effective and not as efficient. Efficiency is important. That's the foramen, by the way, on her right arm. And it's full of herniations and scar tissue. All that golden color is calcium. It's calcification of damaged tissues. So when you get damaged tissues in your body, over time they calcify. Oh, that's a beautiful herniation right there. That is a monster. So if you're a fan of a movie called, what the hell is it? Pacific Rim. Anybody watch Pacific Rim? Oh, nice. So if you're a fan of Pacific Rim, that's a category 4. Category 4 herniation right there that I just took out. All right? It's category 4. If you're not a fan of Pacific Rim and you've never seen it, go watch it. It's a great movie. All right, any more questions from our audience?
Yes, we have one more question. Uh-huh. This one's from Facebook. It says, how much total laser energy in joules can be given to a patient?
How much total laser energy in joules can you give to a patient? So the body doesn't really do anything with the laser energy. It's directed directly at tissues like the disc, and you could put as much joules as you want in a patient's disc. Typically, we put around 25 joules per disc that we repair. That's just a good average number, 25 joules per disc. And we actually do, believe it or not, keep track of how much joules we put in every single disc. But on an average patient, it's 25 joules per disc. So if we're fixing one disc, 25, two discs, 50, obviously three discs, 75, you can do the math. But yeah, there's no maximum amount of joule energy that patients can take. It's joule energy, laser energy is not like, my God, that's a category 5 right there. Laser energy is not like radiation. You know, radiation, you don't want to be giving patients very much. You want to minimize the amount of radiation. I didn't get it. Yeah, I may not. I think I got a little piece, but category 5, we're going to have to break it up a little more. How you doing over there? Thank you for your help. You're doing great. There's a lot of little moving parts in the OR during surgery, and you're definitely helping with one of them. Thank you. So this category 5, I ripped a little bit of it off. There's another piece of it. You know, just like in the movie, there's not one attack that gets it all. You got to just work on it, you know. You got to take shots, and hopefully your shots land and do some damage. Eventually you defeat the monster, the kaiju. Right? Right, Luis? Oh, yeah. So I'm trying to chop it right here, chop it off. So yeah, we go to battle every day, you know, for our patients, fighting their monsters, like herniated discs, annular tears, pinched nerves. That's what we're doing. Just the weapon we have now is so amazing. This endoscopic Deuk laser disc repair procedure. It's like the plasma cannon, you know, if you're a fan of the movie Pacific Rim. I didn't like the second one, by the way. I thought the second one was horrible. Anybody else agree? The first, you didn't see the second one? Yeah, don't waste your money. I'm sorry if you like the second one, but I just couldn't get into the second one. It was so corny. Huh? Thank you. Yeah, the irrigation's, you can tell now when the irrigation is really nice and strong, if you get a clear image, and when the irrigation is running out, things, you start to see the blood bleeding a little bit more. All right. So once I get this last bits of herniation here on the patient's right side of C5-6, we'll probably be clear, but there's a huge herniation here. And what I'm doing is I'm just breaking it apart with the plasma cannon, the laser cannon. All right, any more questions? That's the foramen.
Yes, we have a question from Sue, Facebook.
Sue, nice.
After all the positive results from the Deuk laser disc repair, is the neurosurgery community any more receptive to changing the current push for invasive surgery?
Well, it's a great question, Sue. You've hit the nail on the head. The problem with spine surgery is there is a massive support for fusion. And fusion surgery is very invasive, very damaging for patients. And the support really comes from people making a lot of money doing fusions. And the surgeons, believe it or not, they make a lot more money for fusion surgery, but they don't make anywhere near the kind of money that the companies that manufacture the instruments and the implants, the companies that make the plates, the screws, the rods, the cages, the bone graft, they make billions and billions of dollars every year in profit. And so what they've done, which is quite ingenious, is they've infiltrated, in every sense of that word, they have infiltrated the training grounds for new young spine surgeons. And they literally, and they did this to me, they will offer to take you out to dinner, to take you to trips, let's go fishing. And this is why the government put the kibosh on all this years ago. They said doctors should not be getting, you know, bribes, basically, for lack of a better word, from these companies in exchange for using their products. So, but, you know, it hasn't worked the way it's supposed to work. I got to use the grabber. So these companies are still treating doctors with huge financial rewards for doing fusions and artificial discs. And that is in the deepest, most ingrained levels at our universities and at the meetings that the doctors go to and the journals and even the editorial boards of the journals. The editorial boards of the journals are corrupted, totally corrupted by this money because of advertising income. So the journals, if you notice, they run ads. And, you know, these companies pay the journals, the medical journals where we publish our research, they pay those journals millions of dollars a year in advertisement. And in exchange, they want the journals to just publish their fusion study results that are showing fusions are good and artificial discs are good, etc. The point is, these companies have completely taken over American medicine. Whether it's spinal implants, whether it's drugs, whether it's vaccines, you name it, there's advertising everywhere. There's support for their agenda by the journal, and it's shameful. And good science is not getting out there. Good medicine is dead, except for small little pockets like me. And what I've had to do this procedure, I mean, years ago when I started, I had zero support from anyone. I had to pay for all the surgeries out of my own pocket, you know, out of my retirement money. And I still do sometimes, but thank God that it's catching on and people are getting more aware of it. But the reality is that as long as surgery like this doesn't put implants in people, they are not these doctors are not going to be they're not going to be told by their residency programs, their training programs, their chairman to do this kind of surgery. Okay? There's literally so much money now that's taken in from these companies by the educational institutions that it's virtually impossible to get rid of it. So, you know, there's things I can fix in this lifetime, and there's things I can't fix. And I can't fix that. At least I have no intention of fixing it at this time. I got too much else to do, you know? So I need other people to step up and help out. If they want their surgeons to offer this surgery, they have to somehow get the surgeon to do it. You know, I've offered to train surgeons from around the world. I've given talks around the world, and yet, where are the surgeons? They all want to do fusions. The surgeons I've hired or tried to hire in the past, I've said, you're going to learn how to do surgery better for the patient, less invasive, no fusions, and they don't want to. The fusion surgeries just pay so much more money than non-fusions. The artificial disc surgeries pay almost as much as fusions, but not quite. So there's really no motivation by the surgeons to financially to do what's best for patients. And that's the problem. I am exceptional in that I started doing these surgeries 16 years ago and not getting paid. I did them on my own dime. Of course, I expected to get paid, I just never did. So, long story short, if I had to do it all over again, I would. Because my goal in life is to do things the best that I can possibly do them for people. And that includes surgery. And I used to be a big fusion surgeon. That's all I did, fusions. And I did a lot, and I did them really well, and I made really good money. As a matter of fact, it's my fusion surgeries that paid for all the laser surgeries I did, because at the time, I was billing insurances, and they weren't paying. So I didn't know they weren't going to pay, of course. And the fact is, insurance companies basically write the laws. And there's only one way to get an insurance company to pay, and that's in court. And you have to take them to court and sue them. But the problem is they write the laws. So when you go to court, and they've basically written the rules in the court, so of course they're going to win. So it's an uphill battle for everybody. Except the insurance companies, who are doing quite well. Now, there are insurance companies that do pay, more so now than ever before, but they're few and far between and unpredictable for the most part. So this patient in particular, we made an agreement with her insurance company, and they have approved her surgery. So we are hopefully going to be paid, but you never know. One of the biggest problems with insurance companies is they've managed to create a system where they always get paid every month on time before they give you anything, right? Before you get your benefits, you pay them. But when it comes to paying doctors and hospitals, they actually don't pay. They don't pay us for years sometimes. And we have to spend massive amounts of time and energy and money trying to get paid just by following up, sending letters. And of course, they try everything in their power not to pay. They'll say, "Oh, you didn't submit the claim properly. You forgot to dot the I." We don't know if that's the right, if that's an I or if that's an L. I mean, just stupid stuff. They do this all day long, and it works. It works because doctors don't get paid, hospitals don't get paid. And we have to write off that debt. So who pays, right? I can't tell you how many surgeries we've been told we'd be paid. We've been approved, prior authorization, prior certification, and then they don't pay. So insurance companies are just destroying healthcare. That's the truth. And I think if the insurance companies would consistently pay for care like this, then we have a better chance of doctors doing it. But the reality is, doctors feel like, and it's true, how are we supposed to pay for our patients' care? We've already spent our whole lives sacrificing any money, basically to train in our training programs, And then when we get out, we're supposed to quickly make up for all the money we never made. And now we have to pay for our patient's care on top of that. It's impossible. Absolutely impossible. So our system is broken. It can be fixed. I could fix it. But the reality is I'm not a political person. So I don't go to Washington and I don't go to Tallahassee in Florida. And I tried talking to a senator to help us. He was useless. He went out to a steak dinner with Blue Cross Blue Shield and didn't do anything to help us get these surgeries covered. So I won't mention names, but the senators and congressmen are themselves totally corrupted. They're bought. They're owned by the insurance companies. So we need a massive revolution.
I have another question from you from Facebook. Do you always try to see the dura or PLL in this procedure?
Great question. Yeah, great question. That's the PLL. We're seeing the PLL. I don't want to see the dura. Most herniations, you don't see the dura. Like this is PLL fibers here, and there's some scar tissue. So my job is to get rid of the herniation, but not see the dura, preferably. The dura is behind that, and that's all PLL. And you can see there's just a tiny smidgen of herniation there, but it's calcified, and but otherwise things are looking pretty good. So that's the foramen. I'm going to try to clean a little bit more out of there. I'm going to have to pull back, and I'm going to have to reposition. Here's a big piece of herniation here. It was just sitting right outside the tube. I don't know if I can pull it out. I'll try, but it's pretty big. So you can see it. This is a process. It's not like I go to the back of the disc and there's one herniation there and I just grab it and we're done. It's honestly piecemeal. Little pieces are coming out. And sometimes we get a whole big piece of herniation because that's how the patient herniated, was one big piece. But you know, the herniations are going to come out the way they herniated in pieces. And that's one of the advantages of endoscopic surgery, is you can actually see the herniation inside the disc or outside the disc. So
we have another question from John.
Sure.
Does the ligament structure provide more than enough stability after the surgery is done?
Does the ligament structure provide more than enough stability after the surgery is done? So there's a lot more than the ligament providing stability. There's the anterior longitudinal ligament. There's the posterior longitudinal ligament. There's the rest of the annulus fibrosis around the disc. There's also muscles around the neck. And there's the facet joints in the back and the facet joint capsule. So there's a lot of other tissues besides the posterior annulus that provides support and stability. That's only one small piece of the equation. Yeah, and the integrity of that posterior ligament was already compromised when the herniations occurred and the inflammation occurred. It's truly, in my opinion, inflammation from the herniation that does most of the damage to the posterior ligament. Rather than trauma, I think it's inflammatory damage. That's based on all my surgeries that I've done, my observations. Normally, with a cervical disc herniation, it almost never passes through the posterior ligament. It's rare. There's another herniation. We call those herniations subligamentous, meaning they're below the ligament, okay? towards our side where we are. They're not past the ligament. They're below. They're on our side of the ligament, towards the disc side. So a herniation is typically subligamentous, meaning it hasn't gone out through the posterior longitudinal ligament. And that's what we're seeing 90% of the time. Only rarely does a herniation go past the posterior longitudinal ligament. And then you got to open it and look for it in the epidural space. So we had to do a couple of those over the last few months. But this one here, I would say, is mostly subligamentous. There is a little bit that's gone through the posterior ligament, but maybe 5% of the herniation is through the posterior ligament from what I'm seeing. All right. Just about done here at this disc. This has been a very, very difficult one to do because it's been a lot more pieces than I thought it would be based on our MRI. And more scarred. You can see there's no real bone spurs, which is good. I mean, except for the front, which we're not dealing anything with that. How is our patient doing, doctor? Good. Good. Stable. Excellent. If you're happy, I'm happy. Things are going well here. It's just takes a while to get it all out. Another question?
Yeah, we have a question from Jim. Is there any hope with only Medicare and BCBS?
There is hope. There's always hope, Jim. The reality is that the reality is you're going to have to advocate for yourselves. What that means is you're going to have to contact Medicare. Tell them you want this procedure covered and that it should be covered. But the reality is, if you watch enough of my videos, you know who runs Medicare. Well, you said it. BCBS, in your case. In other cases, it's United Healthcare, Cigna. So here's what's happened, unbeknownst to you, is that Blue Cross Blue Shield has gone to Medicare and said, we will save you money if you let us run Medicare, manage it. And Medicare said, okay, how much are you going to save? And they said at least 50% of what you would normally pay. And if we can save you money, we want to keep 30% of every dollar we save. And the government said, okay, we can do that. So now Blue Cross Blue Shield that runs Medicare is literally denying your surgery because Medicare gave them the power to do that. And in exchange for every dollar they've denied and saved Medicare, they get to keep 30 cents. So you tell me that's fair to you. And of course, all of this is kept very secret, covered up. But basically, that's what happens. Blue Cross, United Healthcare, Cigna, wherever your Medicare administrator is, they don't have those names, by the way, usually, if it's a Medicare administrator. They have names like First Coast Services, or they have other funny names, but they're owned by the big private insurance companies. And they are being paid to save money for the government, basically ration care. So what do you think is going to happen when something like this technology comes along? You think people want this? Of course they want it. Of course they want it. So what do you think the insurance companies are going to say? They're going to say no. Right? I mean, when you have a better technology that makes sense and everybody wants it, the insurance companies want to say no because you're going to increase utilization. What utilization is, it is the use, or utilization. Utilize means to use, the utilization of those services. That's going to drive up the overall cost of healthcare, right? And in the end, the truth is, the private insurance companies that manage Medicare benefits, like Blue Cross Blue Shield, they don't care about people. They just care about money. They don't give a damn about a human being suffering or about their medical problems. All of it, they'll put, you know, people on the phone to talk to you that you might actually think they care about you. They care about you the same way a wolf cares about a sheep. It's a meal. And the wolf wants to make sure you're around when they're hungry. And so that's what insurance companies are. They're protecting you for eating you. As long as you keep paying that premium, they'll provide you service. But when you stop paying that premium, they don't provide you anything, do they? So they're what we call a fair weather friend. We're done at this level. That was a long one. How much energy did we deliver to this disc?
23.8.
All right, so 24 joules. Yeah, we just call it joules. Basically, 24 kilojoules. So, like I said earlier, about 25 is the average. For cervical, it may be closer to 20. All right, we're putting a little antiseptic in. This antiseptic was developed right here at the Space Coast of Florida, where we are, right by SpaceX and Blue Origin, NASA. Right, Luis? And it's called Betadine, and we use it. This may be clogged, that's why, right? So we use Betadine all the time for irrigation of our surgical wounds when we're done. All right. Now, we're done with C5-6. Our next goal is to leave C5-6 and go down to C6-7. And I can tell you right now, that's going to be really, really hard to do. But I'm not going to give up just because it's challenging. We're going to do our very best to do that. So we're going to bring our x-ray machine back in so I can see in the spine where exactly I have to go to get to C6-7. We call that navigation. We're going to use the x-ray machine and her spine on the x-ray machine relative to the surgical instrument, and I'm going to navigate that surgical instrument over to the next disc using the x-ray machine. Now, what's the name of this platform?
Yeah.
Huh?
Cios
flow. So we already have the Cios flat panels, right? What are they called?
So those are.
What's this one on?
Yes. Thank you. You have the older version of what this is now.
Is it called the older ones are called the flows too?
No, they're.
All right, don't worry. I don't mean to put you on the spot. All right, so we have the Cios, but this is an updated version.
Fusion.
Yeah, I think you're right, Cios Fusion. Now, does this have vascular software?
This particular model, yes, it does.
Is that extra?
That is.
All right, I've got so many C-arms with vascular software we never used. Okay, very good. So you can see where we are. We're at the C5-6, and we need to see the next disc down. But we don't really need to count from the top. I just need to be able to see the next disc down. So we're going to need an inline traction. We're going to need a shoulder pull, gentle. And then I'm going to need to work around Luis's arm here. And the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to leave the dilator in position, but I'm going to take out the tube and I'll apply a little pressure shot. All right, so that's a little too far south. Let's see if we can find a happy medium. Yeah, and that disc is right there. That's actually pretty good, actually. I think we're wagged off a little bit. If you can improve the wag, that would be good. So unlike the C5-6, I don't need to count down because I already know where we are. I just need to be able to see that disc. I think you went the wrong way on the wag. That's, I think, better, but we need, all right. I could see the disc space, the beginnings of the disc space. If I could just get a little bit clearer picture. Now, why are we struggling here? Because our patient's anatomy is unique to her, and every patient has different anatomy. The truth is I can't tell you ahead of time for before surgery, unless I can't tell you for sure that I won't be able to get a disc. And I can't tell you for sure I will. But generally, getting C5-6, C6-7 is not a problem. As long as the neck is long and the collarbone is low. But this patient's neck is not long. Her collarbone is a bit high. And she's got very big shoulders, very broad shoulders. She's strong. She's actually, I can't tell you details about her, but if you knew what job she had, you'd know why she's so tough. All right, let's just say it has to do with security. Okay, I need to see that C6-7 disc just a little bit better, guys, before we get started here. So, yeah, I'm not really seeing it with this angle. It's almost like that collarbone or rib, whatever that is there, is a little bit in the way. I think your orbit's fine, but we need to do something either with the wag to better visualize it. Are we pulling on the shoulders, guys?
Yeah.
Luis, you want to pull the shoulder and see where we are? Okay, is the scope still on? I just saw the scope.
Yeah.
Yeah, the scope should not be on. How come the scope? Oh, okay.
The light is not on.
All right. Fair enough.
All right.
All right, let's do our best here. Let's see what we've got. Actually, it's a little misleading. I think our wag is off there. It's actually not bad though. I could see the disc. That's actually pretty good. It's not terrible there. We may be okay with that. I like the zoomed in view a little better. Actually, what do you think about that, Luis? That looks pretty good, right? All right, I think I could live with that. Is there any way to zoom it in a little bit? So notice, folks, I'm taking my time to get the picture perfect, because you don't want to get the picture worked out once you've left the disc. Shot?
Huh?
What?
The laser? Yeah.
That's not the laser. That's just a targeting beam.
Okay.
It's a, sure, yeah, laser lights. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, laser light is, a laser energy is invisible. But that just shows you where it would be. All right, let's see what we've got here. Little shoulder pull, head in line.
Yep.
Give it to me, your best. Hey, that's amazing right there. If you guys can give me that picture, that's perfect.
Yep,
I can live with that. All right, shot. So I'm coming out of the disc, I'm out, shot. I wanna stay in the midline as I march down, shot. I need an AP quick.
You stay here.
I got to make sure I stay right in the middle of the disc, you know, right along the anterior longitudinal ligament. Shot. I can tell you right now, it seems to be quite a bit of soft tissue resistance. So hopefully I can get down there. Everybody hold you. You guys are all doing fantastic. Just need it for a couple more minutes. Give me that lateral, please, again. All right. Shot? I think I'm there. Yeah, give me an AP. We are definitely there. Everybody hold your positions. Let's just make sure we're midline. I can't tell. I feel an annulus though, it feels like. Quick, shot. There's a quick AP. Yeah, it's actually pretty damn good. Give me a lateral. That looks really good. In the annulus, give it to me. AP, stay there, stay there, stay there. Don't relax the shoulders, give me an AP quick. Gotta make sure I'm still in the midline. Yeah, that's pretty darn good. Yeah. All right, lateral. Almost done, boys and girls. Well, I'm happy we made it. Let's just make sure we get back there properly. You can see the spinous process looks like a little heart there. Shot? She's just telling us how much she loves all of our effort. Good, relax everybody, just for a minute. And then we're gonna come back. Let's just see where we are, pipe cleaner. All right, let's get a shot and see where we are. That's not bad. I can live with that. That's great, guys. Great job. Shot. I'm going to clean out the anything that might have come up the pipe. Shot. All right, perfect. We're going to do our discogram, and then we'll get started. So. Now, I think shot. Yeah, a little more. Shot. That's perfect. We got our discogram done. I know it's hard for you guys to see AP, but I'll just say anyone that is going to be doing endoscopic spine surgery like this, my advice is don't do hard cases like this, you know, for the first year. Just do the easier stuff. And you know, don't take unnecessary risk until you develop a level of confidence with the procedure. I will say that what gave me tremendous confidence was my background in anatomy, and also all the, believe it or not, shot, the vagus nerve stimulators that I did. This was for epilepsy patients. I did a lot of vagus nerve stimulators when I was a resident. I had a NIH grant. I was the principal investigator for 2 years studying epilepsy in rats brains, you know. And while I was doing that benchwork research, I also got into the operating room because nobody wanted to operate with an epilepsy surgeon. Neurosurgeons don't like doing epilepsy surgery. It's not sexy, like vascular or tumor or skull base. Epilepsy surgery is pretty much, we call it functional neurosurgery now, was very unpopular among the residents. Shot. So Dr. Roper was also like hated by everyone. And because he was such an ass at times, which I figured out what triggered him, and I just made sure to keep him happy in the operating room, you know? Anyway, he became my mentor, and I worked in his lab, which was also NIH funded, and I had my own grant shot as the principal investigator to study dysplastic cortex. And when he operated, I would go assist him. And I did a lot of vagus nerve stimulator surgeries, exposures in the neck. So I got very, very, very good at meticulous surgical dissection of the neck. And basically the vagus nerve sits in the carotid sheath, shot, just in front of the spine. So I had 2 years of, you know, hundreds of procedures where we're implanting stimulators on the vagus nerve to reduce seizures. Shot. All right, we're at the back of the disc. Number two, C6-7. And let's just do one quick zoomed out x-ray to show exactly where we are so I could see C2. Are you recording the x-ray?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, why don't you go ahead and do that? Now scale it up to C2 and let's see. All right, so we got to go a little more north. and do your shot. There, C2, and now come south. Let's expose south. So we need to be a little bit further south. I think you went too far north. So just kind of split the difference. All right, there it is, actually. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. All right, so we can see our tube is at the back of the disc at 6, 7. We're literally right on the posterior longitudinal ligament, right where the herniation is at the annular tear. So we're going to do a debridement. You can get the fluoro out. Great job, everybody. At this point, we've done the hardest part of the surgery. And now we'll just clean this disc up. Now it's going to take this disc 1 year to fully strong heal to its maximum. And the way the disc is going to heal is the body is able to heal these disc, these annular tears, as long as the nuclear material is not stuck in there. Why don't you run the video again of the Deuk laser disc repair and how the annular debridement works to allow the disc to heal?
Yes, sir.
Disc herniations are a common cause of chronic neck pain. The inflamed annular tear causes neck pain. Inflammation of the nerve roots causes arm pain. A Band-Aid-sized skin incision is made. A small tube is inserted without damaging the bone or soft tissues. The laser removes the herniation and debrides the annular tear. The annular tear heals on its own. It can take up to 12 months. If you have a herniated or bulging disc and neck pain, submit your MRI for a free review at www.mri.dukespine.com.
All right, so we're just removing more herniations now from C6-7. We're actually able to access 6-7, which I was worried we wouldn't be able to at first, but with my team doing an amazing job, Dr. Berndes and Luis and Flynn and everybody, I too many names to mention, even the x-ray machine. I just wonder, there's a herniation, by the way, in case you didn't know, the big old snowball. I'm just wondering if, Jordan, do you think we would have been able to see what we saw with the other fluoro? And you think we would have seen it, though? There's another herniation right there. Huh?
I think it's a possibility, but it would have been a lot of turning, a lot of extra inches to take.
So, the reason we're talking about this is we're assessing a new fluoroscope, the most advanced in the world, now from Siemens. They keep popping out new fluoroscopes every 5 years, 6 years that are a huge advancement. Let's show them the herniation real quick. Put the light on here. I just pulled this one out. I've been pulling out herniations. Can you see that, Kevin?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I've been pulling some fragments like this out, but you can appreciate the size of this. There's my finger. And I've got a big hand. I've got a size 9 hand, probably one of the biggest hands out there. And you can see my thumbnail is here, and our grabber is here, and that's one of the herniated fragments that I just took out. All right? So I literally pulled it out of the back of the disc. Here's another one right here that actually has floated out. And, you know, you can see that these herniations, I didn't create them. They were already there. And appreciate the fact that they're different sizes and different shapes. What these are is these are nucleus pulposus that has pushed out through the tear over time. And her injury was 3 years ago, and I can tell you, looking at this disc, it looks like it happened 3 years ago. So I can concur that the annular injury and the amount of herniations and the appearance of the herniations is consistent with her work injury. Very consistent. I'm certain of it. That's one of the nice things about the endoscopic treatment is you can actually see things inside the disc. You can see the injury. All right. There's still more herniations to come out. So If you missed that, don't worry, we got more. Grab some popcorn, Diet Coke, sit down and enjoy. We have any more questions from our audience?
Yes, we have one from Sue on Facebook. How many Deuk laser disc repair could be safely be performed in a standard working week by one surgical team?
How many Deuk laser disc repairs? I'm going to repeat the question as I always do. That way the audience has the benefit of hearing it and we can capture it nicely. How many Deuk laser disc repairs can be safely done in one work week with one OR crew? So great question. I believe you're saying one operating room and one crew for that operating room. It really depends, to be quite honest with you, on the skill of the team and the efficiency of the team. So in an ideal world, in a very experienced team, the anesthesiologist does, you know, his or her job properly in terms of, you know, depth of anesthesia, recovery, et cetera, you know, minimizing kinds of complications. And the surgeon does their job of doing the surgery efficiently. You could probably do 5 days a week. You could probably do easily 5 surgeries a day. So 25 a week could be done with one operating room with the right team and the right surgeon and the right staff. 25 a week. That's just the number I'm saying. And depending on how many discs on that each patient, you know, obviously that would vary, but let's say an average of 2 discs per patient. Other questions? That was a good one. I enjoyed that one. More herniation right here. Look at these things just coming out. It's beautiful. Isn't that amazing, folks? All this beauty of this surgery is that we're fixing the source of the pain and the all the symptoms of the herniated disc, basically. We're fixing them without opening the patient up and without bleeding, without fusing, without metal, without restricting movement. I'm actually having to use the laser to jiggle this thing out of here. That's so cool, huh? It's getting a little monotonous though, but there we go. Come on now, be reasonable. It's almost there. I'll have to go retrieve it.
We have another question from Stan.
Sure, Stan.
Should I try doing epidural stereo injections for my L4, L5 herniation that are giving me back pain and leg pain while I wait for a surgical solution?
Should you do epidural steroid injections while you're waiting for your surgery if you have back and leg pain? Yes, I think epidurals are a good option, but obviously for you, I can't say that because I don't know enough about you to say that. But in general, the answer is yes. So what are some of the things that would be a no? Well, let's say you have a bad reaction to steroids. Let's say you're diabetic and you're a brittle diabetic, so your sugars would skyrocket if you have that epidural. That's not a good thing. So there are some contraindications to the steroids, medical contraindications, but other than medical contraindications of steroid, as long as your surgeon is competent and they don't hurt you with the epidural, in other words, they don't cause a complication, like stick the needle into your nerve or cause an epidural hematoma, which I've seen, by the way. There's a lot of bad pain management doctors out there. They're very sloppy, they don't care, and they hurt patients bad, big time. And we actually have one patient who was paralyzed from an epidural, not our patient, but from another company just down the road. Like Florida Pain or something like that. They stuck the needle in the spinal cord and injected the medicine in the spinal cord, which is a big no-no. You never put anything in the spinal cord. And that patient was paralyzed as a result of their epidural. So my point is simple. As long as you have a good surgeon or operator to do the procedure, and as long as you don't have any medical contraindications, then an epidural is a great temporizing treatment for the pain associated with a disc injury. It's not going to give you long-term relief, as you've obviously eloquently pointed out, but it certainly could give you some good temporary relief while you're waiting. Thank you for asking. That is a fantastic question, and it's great for the whole audience, by the way. Everyone got the benefit from hearing that. We encourage you all to ask questions. That's what the point of this live broadcast is I want people to have the opportunity to see what I'm doing, at the same time, ask questions.
He has a follow-up question. He just wants to get your thoughts on the ozone lumbar injections.
Ozone lumbar injections. So what are my thoughts? It's a great question. I don't have much experience with them, and I've learned in my lifetime of 26 years as a neurosurgeon that you don't foo-foo treatments until you really have more understanding about them. So what would I say about it? I just don't have enough experience with it. Do I believe it would work scientifically based on my knowledge? No. But then again, I didn't believe that this surgery would work either, laser surgery that I'm doing. So when I first heard that people were doing laser spine surgery, I laughed and I said, that's garbage, it doesn't work. But I was wrong. As long as it's done properly, it does work. So I don't know enough about ozone, my friend. It's a great question and I appreciate you asking it, but I don't know everything, obviously, and that's one thing I don't know enough about. I would love to find out the answer. And obviously, if it does work, we would do it here at Deuk Spine. I've just heard about it once before, and I'll be honest with you, we do have a doctor here who does what's called pain management. He does all the epidurals and all these, you know, like ozone and things like that. But I don't think he's doing ozone treatment. So, right? No. Luis is saying no. He works with them all the time. So I don't know his opinion on it. I'd be interested to find out. Dr. Patel, he's an expert. But I think if it worked, we would be doing it. And so when I say I don't have a lot of confidence that it works, it's only because we don't do it. And it's not that we don't have the money to buy the equipment. It's not that we don't want to do progressive things. We do. We want to be the most progressive spine institute in the world. That's our goal. And we would be doing it if it works. I just don't think Dr. Patel believes it works. So, oh, look at that herniation. Do you guys see that thing? Just kind of rock itself out. That was so cool. There it is. It's just too big. Yeah, the nice thing about these surgeries being broadcast on YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, and LinkedIn is that you can actually go back and watch. You can hit rewind. And you can see how that herniation literally just came right out of the epidural space. I would say 5 minutes, doctor. 5 minutes. I'm telling my anesthesiologist I expect 5 minutes. Of course, he knows that that's code for 10 minutes because he doesn't believe me. Every surgeon always says like 5 minutes, but they really are 10 minutes. So we just have this... a situation where when you really love what you do, you kind of lose track of time, and it feels like a very short time, but it actually is longer. So he knows that my 5 minutes really means 10 minutes. So, but I'm telling him because we want to start to lighten up the patient's anesthetic so we can wake this patient up shortly. Remember, this case is done under general anesthesia. Patient is intubated and asleep completely for the whole surgery. It's a pretty big herniation here, and I'm trying to break it up into pieces and float the pieces out. Don't feel bad for the herniation being dismembered, because honestly, they're not good things to begin with. But you see how I can take a large herniation that's too big to fit, and I can use the laser as well to break it up. So going back to what I talked about earlier, how there are people out there, a lot of them, who say, oh, laser spine surgery doesn't work. I talked to the Mayo Clinic. They said it's unnecessary, blah, blah, blah. All I can tell you is there's a lot of ignorance out there. Somebody asked me about the fibers of the posterior longitudinal ligament. That's them right there. There's still a little bit of herniated disc sitting on top, and that's dura down there that you're seeing. So if you want to see dura, that's it. It's like right there. This is mostly scar tissue on top of the PLL. All right, so it looks like we've gotten rid of most of that herniation. I'm just going to check a little bit more, and then we'll be done. Great questions from our audience today. I really appreciate you guys asking. I love the audience participation. By the way, we're going to be losing our broadcaster, Kevin. He is leaving us this week, unfortunately. So we may have to go again a period of time without broadcasting. But understand that it's not because we want to. If you want to send in a donation, like a large amount of money, I might be able to convince Kevin to stay. But other than that, he's leaving. So, such is the world today. All right, I'm looking at this foramen on her left, and I don't see any more herniated discs. I just see some scar tissue here and there, but nothing pushing on the nerve. That's the dura right there, by the way, the dura mater, okay? And we're not gonna zap that, but I just wanna get all the crud out of this foramen. I think we're done here. I don't see anything more. I'm gonna take one more look to the other side. And remember, with the cervicals, we can go side to side. We can get the whole herniation out, both sides. Irrigation, how are we doing, guys?
No,
it's okay, we're done. I don't see anything else. Great job. Laser off. So why don't we run a comparison for the audience so they can see the difference between the Deuk laser disc repair and a fusion, okay? And when we show you this video, folks, I want you to understand that this happens to be a fusion we're showing you, called an ACDF, but it could also be an artificial disc because they're basically the same. Now, before you do that, I just want to show everybody, okay? Don't go yet, Kevin. I want to show the audience how small this surgical incision is, okay?
Yes, sir.
But go ahead and cue up the Deuk laser disc repair versus cervical fusion. We're done here, doctor. Now we're going to wake this patient up. I'm going to show you the incision. Just a minute. And so you guys can see the whole surgery was done through this tube, right? It's a 4-millimeter tube. So now I'm going to get it out of the disc. And we just apply a little pressure just to make sure we don't have any vein bleeding. And then I'm going to show you this incision. And afterwards, we'll cut to a video that kind of compares what this woman would have had to have done, called an ACDF fusion. And you can see side by side the Deuk laser disc repair, how much better it is. There really is no surgery for disc injuries in the human body better than the Deuk laser disc repair. And now we're doing thoracic spines as well. We do lumbar, thoracic, and cervical. So there's not a disc that can hide from us, right? All right, you ready to see the incision? Here it is. Bam. Right there, 4 millimeters, the whole surgery. Got it? Type up your questions for me. I'll be over there in the conference room to answer them live for you. Type up a question and I'll answer it for you live. Other than that, make sure you go to your app store and download the Deuk Spine Institute app. It's free. It's got great information on there to teach you about the spine. And also we have our YouTube channel, if you want to check it out, free MRI review. If you know somebody with neck or back pain, we'll be happy to review their MRI for free and do a quick Zoom conference to go over what our findings are, as well as our recommendations, and answer questions, all for free, as a public service.
With traditional spinal fusion surgery. A symptomatic disc causing neck or back pain can include bulging discs, herniated discs, ruptured discs, degenerative discs, protruding discs, spinal stenosis, radiculopathy, and sciatica. This patient can choose traditional fusion surgery or the Deuk laser disc repair to help alleviate the pain caused by and within the symptomatic discs. Here, two patients with comparable disc injuries are treated. On the left, the highly invasive spinal fusion, and on the right, the least invasive Deuk laser disc repair. The spinal fusion requires a very large incision, usually leaving a large scar. The Deuk laser disc repair requires only a very small incision, usually less than a half an inch long. In this small opening, a cylindrical rod, called a dilator, is inserted to gently spread the muscle to create a small passage and guide through which the surgery is performed endoscopically. The incision for the fusion continues, including penetrating the skin, fat tissue, and multiple layers of muscle through to the bone. With the Deuk laser disc repair, a mallet is used to advance the tip of the dilator into the symptomatic disc. A tube, called the tubular retractor, slides over the dilator and is carefully positioned into the disc, again using the mallet. The rest of the entire Deuk laser disc repair surgery will occur inside this narrow tube. To access the spinal fusion requires the muscle to be separated from the vertebrae. This very invasive action causes trauma and permanent damage to the muscles. Whereas in the endoscopic Deuk laser disc repair, the muscle is not damaged. The endoscope camera is inserted into the tubular retractor to allow the surgeon to guide the laser inside each symptomatic disc. The fiber optic laser used in the Deuk laser disc repair is manipulated with great accuracy to remove only painful inflammatory tissue from the disc. In this highly magnified view, the laser is used to precisely remove damaged disc material that is causing the pain. The laser is debriding, or essentially vaporizing, damaged tissue in the disc's outer layer, or annulus, specifically at the annular tear, the source of the rupture or herniation and pain. After the fusion patient's damaged discs are removed, a metal or plastic cage housing bone grafting material is inserted in place of the removed discs. Fusion hardware, by design, is to fuse joints that normally move, preventing natural movement in the damaged portion of the spine. Whereas with the Deuk laser disc repair, there is no loss of movement. Normal movement and flexibility of the disc and joints is preserved. Once the laser has removed the painful part of the annular tear, the endoscope and tubular retractor are removed, leaving less than 1/2 inch incision in the skin, which is closed with a single stitch, Steristrips, and a Band-Aid. Total time for the Deuk laser disc repair surgery, approximately 1 hour. The fusion, however, is still underway. Holes in the spine must be tapped in preparation for the large screws that anchor the fusion hardware. The Deuk laser disc repair patient is in recovery usually 45 to 60 minutes before released to go home. Meanwhile, bone graft material is placed throughout the fusion surgery site. These morselized pieces of bone will eventually grow together to help promote the fusion process. The Deuk laser disc repair patient is soon back home, enjoying life, with a very fast recovery, allowing normal activities without pain. Average surgery time of a traditional two-level fusion is 2.5 hours, with an additional 3 to 4 hours in the recovery room. As we've seen, in comparison, a spinal fusion requires a much larger incision and results in a significant amount of scar tissue. The Deuk laser disc repair's half-inch incision leaves no scar tissue around the spine or nerves. A large amount of bone is removed with a spinal fusion. With the Deuk laser disc repair, no bone is removed. Each disc is accessed through a natural opening in the spine. The entire disc is completely removed in a spinal fusion, even though only 5% may be damaged. The Deuk laser disc repair leaves the normal parts of the disc in place and removes only the painful annular tear on the damaged disc. Fusion requires hardware, including screws, rods, plates, etc. The Deuk laser disc repair does not require any hardware. The patient is totally hardware-free. Fusion surgery is very invasive. Cutting and moving the muscle structures and tissues for a spinal fusion causes trauma, resulting in permanent damage to the muscles. Whereas with the Deuk laser disc repair, there is no damage to the muscles. The Deuk laser disc repair is the least invasive surgery available to repair a damaged disc. With spinal fusions, patients are required to take highly addictive narcotic painkillers, which can cause constipation, bowel, and bladder complications. Due to the minimal pain, narcotics are not needed with the Deuk laser disc repair. Spinal fusions have a high risk for infection. The Deuk laser disc repair has a very low risk for infection. In the 7 years the Deuk laser disc repair has been performed, there have been no infections. Spinal fusion surgery has a very long recovery and requires a great deal of physical therapy and time to heal from the trauma in the muscles and the spine itself. Whereas the recovery from Deuk laser disc repair is in a matter of hours or days, rather than weeks or months. With fusion, the spine is being fused together, losing movement. Whereas there is no fusion with the Deuk laser disc repair, normal movements of the joints in the spine is preserved. Spinal fusion results in loss of mobility. There is no mobility loss with the Deuk laser disc repair. In fact, most Deuk laser disc repair patients experience improved mobility after the surgery. The Deuk laser disc repair is FDA approved. All the instruments and equipment used are FDA approved. This proprietary surgery itself has been peer-reviewed and published and is performed exclusively at the Deuk Spine Institute. With the highest published success rate of 95%, the Deuk laser disc repair is proven to be the most successful and least damaging spinal surgery in the world for the treatment of symptomatic damaged discs causing back pain, neck pain, sciatica, and radiculopathy due to herniated, degenerated, or bulging discs.
Dr. R. Deuk Majan here at Deuk Spine Institute. It's Groundhog Day, I believe, right? February 2nd, so 2/2/2022. And I'm here with one of my patients who traveled from, where did you come from?
Tennessee.
Tennessee. And why would you travel from Tennessee to Florida to Deuk Spine Institute?
I have been miserable for months, and I found you and did a consult with you and knew this is where I needed to come for good treatment and relief.
And what kind of problem were you having that brought you to Deuk Spine Institute?
Severe lower back pain, which turned into sciatica, and it was down my left leg constantly. I slept about 2-3 hours a night at most, and I could not sit for more than 5 minutes, and I had to be standing up.
And did you try some other treatments in Tennessee or elsewhere?
I did. You know, when this whole thing started and it was a bad flare, I thought I'll be able to work through this. Chiropractic, physical therapy, 2 spinal injections, massage therapy.
And how did you know those treatments did not work for you?
I had no relief at all. My sleeping continued to get worse, and my pain was never better.
And do you have relief now?
Absolutely. I would say I have 95% relief.
Awesome.
And, It's amazing. After surgery yesterday, I put on a back brace. I walked out of here. I sat down yesterday for probably over an hour and had lunch. Last night, in bed, I had zero pain. It's a miracle.
Well, we're very happy that you're doing so well. And your surgery was a great one because we fixed 2 discs. You had a herniated disc at L4-5, L5-S1. And you can see in this footage right here, that we grabbed the herniation out, and it was one of the herniations was really big, and it was really gratifying to get it off because it was resting on your sciatic nerve. Once we took it out, I think your sciatic nerve probably felt a sigh of relief.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, and the surgery went very well. The laser debridement of the annulus went well, and I feel like your pain's going to be gone. It's not going to come back.
I would agree.
All right, very
absolutely.
Good. Well, is there anything else you want to tell your viewers?
Folks, if you're suffering and you're not getting relief from those non-invasive therapies, then come see Dr. Deuk and have him look at your MRI and give a diagnosis. And if you need to have surgery, come down here. He will take good care of you, and so will his team.
I really appreciate that. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I'm Dr. Ari Deuk-Mazin. It's January 26, 2022, and I'm here with one of my patients who you underwent the Deuk laser disc repair on your lower back for some herniated discs about a week ago.
Yes.
How are you feeling today?
Unbelievable. For almost 3 years, I had lower back pain, and it just, you know, it just nags at you, wears you out. And then I came here, and you were the first one. I went to two other surgeons, and neither one of them picked up what was wrong with me, even though I had the MRI. And you came in, and you told me exactly what was going on, and you performed the laser surgery, and I'm like a different person.
Yeah.
A week later.
Yeah, you were a different person the next day, right? The day after, you had no pain, remember?
No, absolutely.
Yeah, so that pain's gone for the rest of your life. How does that make you feel?
New life.
Good. And, you know, a long time ago, I remember when people did something great, you say, what are you going to do now? They say, I'm going to Disneyland. You already went, I can see.
No, my wife's a big Disneyland
fan. Good for you. All right. So, sounds like we helped you with your back pain, and it sounds like you're very satisfied.
Oh, yeah. I'm recommending a friend of mine in Connecticut to come here. You have to come here. If you go anywhere else, I really think you're going to be wasting your time. So this guy just looks at you, and he can tell what needs to be done. He's a fantastic talent, and I'm very grateful that I came here.
Well, we're grateful you did too, because it's going to change your life for the better. Congratulations.
Thank you, Doc.
You're welcome. Good morning, I'm Dr. Deuk-Mazin. I'm here with one of my patients, and you traveled to Deuk Spine Institute here in Florida from where?
New York, Poughkeepsie, New York.
Awesome. And why did you come from New York to Deuk Spine here in Florida?
Because I heard that this was the best place for me to go.
What kind of problems were you having that you needed to come here?
I had lower back problems and numbness in my leg, which was my left leg. This was the best place for me to come.
Okay. So you had back pain, sciatica down your left leg, pain shooting down the left leg.
Yes.
And that was just yesterday, right?
Yes, that's correct. Yep.
And what, do you still have your back pain today?
No more back pain.
It's gone?
Gone.
And is that because we have you doped up on powerful painkillers?
Nope, none whatsoever.
It isn't. Did anybody in New York offer you spine surgery to fix your back?
Yep, yes they did.
Yeah.
And they wanted to fuse it.
Yeah. And you've had surgery before. You had a microdiscectomy, and that helped you for a little while?
Yes.
But the symptoms came back?
Came back.
Yeah. All right. Well, they're not going to come back this time. So what do we do to make your pain go away?
You fixed my back. We did arthroscopic.
That's right. Arthroscopic spine surgery called the Deuk laser disc repair. So leg pain's gone, back pain's gone.
Everything is gone.
You happy?
You did. Oh, I'm very happy.
You're smiling.
Yeah. I tell you.
Congratulations.
Thank you so much.
We did it all through a 7mm incision, just that big. And you can actually watch that video right here, an animation, to see what it looks like to do the Deuk laser disc repair.
A Band-Aid-sized skin incision is made. A small tube is inserted without damaging the bone or soft tissues. The laser removes the herniation and debrides the annular tear. The annular tear heals on its own.
So now that your surgery is done, what are you going to do?
I'm going to go home and enjoy my life.
Good for you.
Enjoy my life.
Congratulations.
I am very happy.
Anything you want to tell your viewers?
Other than this is the place to come. It's worth the travel.